God promises to make us unshakable. And that happens when we surrender to Jesus as our Lord. But that depends on whether or not we see Him as our Lord. There used to be an old game show years ago that's recently made a comeback and returned to the airwaves called To Tell the Truth. During that game show, there will be three different contestants, two of which are frauds. And they're asked various questions to discover their identity. And at the end of the show, the host will ask, will the real person, and whatever their identity or job title is, will the real person please stand up? There's a reason why Jesus asked his disciples, who do you say that I am? They answered as best they knew how. They had their guesses, as some say a prophet, some say a teacher. And Peter finally says, you're the Messiah, the promised one of God. Each one of us will ultimately have to answer that same question throughout our life and at different points in our life when we encounter different stressors that would take our peace from us and make us shakable. We will ask ourselves, will the real Jesus stand up? In Acts chapter 2, verse 36, on the day of Pentecost, Peter is the one who is announcing to the crowd there his conclusion. All the people of Israel should know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God has made Jesus, the man that you nailed to the cross, both Lord and Christ. The message actually refers to that as God has made him both Master and Messiah. A few weeks ago, I explained how the word Lord comes from the word Kyrios, which means Lord and Master. Lord doesn't necessarily communicate much to us in our culture now, but yet at the time it was written, it referred to an owner who had absolute, complete control over the life of the one that he owned. And yet it's the most often used designation in the New Testament as who Jesus is, which is why he says, who do you say that I am? Now you probably remember back in Matthew 14 how Jesus called to Peter to get out of the boat and come join him walking on the water. He did so, amazingly enough. I'm sure nobody was more surprised than Peter, especially as he started to pay attention to the wind and the waves around him. And when he lost his focus on Jesus, of course, he began to sink. And when he did, you remember what he cried out? In desperation, between mouthfuls of water, Lord, save me. It was that word, Kyrios. Lord, my Master, do something. Or in Matthew 20, verse 30, it tells of an occasion when Jesus was passing by two blind men that were there alongside the road. When they heard that it was Jesus that was passing by, they began to interrupt the conversation and cried out, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. They hushed them, and yet they wouldn't be silenced. Lord, have mercy. Jesus healed them. They worshiped him, and they began to follow him. You see, they saw Jesus as their Lord primarily because their life was out of their control. They realized by that point in life that they'd tried everything and nothing was changing anything in their life. That's when we feel the need for God to make us unshakable. When we've tried everything and there's no other answer. That's when we're ready to surrender to Jesus as Lord. Tell us what to do. We're desperate. So what's our response to Jesus? Well, if we just see Jesus as a teacher, then we might be willing to learn from him, but are we willing to do what he says? Or if we know enough about Scripture to acknowledge that he was a prophet, do we listen to what he says as one who speaks on behalf of God with a sense that we need to be obedient to God by doing what Jesus says? Or some people will look at Jesus as a social activist who changed his world and the way that people treated each other. And if that's how you see Jesus, I guess I need to ask, are you inspired enough to serve the poor yourself and to stand against the injustice that you see in our society? See, here's the thing. We can learn from Him. We can listen to Him. We can even be inspired by Him and yet never really surrender to Him as our Lord and Master. That's because we're still trying to be our own Messiah. We only want to serve Christ when it's convenient for us. And convenience can never be mistaken for commitment. A convenient faith will always be a shaky faith at best. So what keeps us from surrendering to the authority of Jesus in our life? Well, honestly, the simple answer is this. It's the same thing that keeps anyone from surrendering, whether it's to Jesus or whether it's to a big brother or a cousin in a wrestling match or whether it's to another country or an enemy army. It's primarily our ego. I don't need your help. I got this. I'll figure it out on my own. I'm good. I can handle it. Or it's our nature. It's our DNA from Adam and Eve. It's that rebellious, defiant spirit that when God says you can do anything you want, you can eat from any tree that you want, just not that one. And of course, that's the very one that was most attractive and magnetic to them. And when considering whether or not they should follow His lead, surrender to His will, the challenge was presented to them. Did He really say that? Why would He do that? And the response, of course, essentially in the words of a three-year-old, "You're not the boss of me. Who do you think you are?" And that's what it comes down to. We want Him to be our Savior, to forgive us of our sins. But to have Him be our Lord, telling us what to do, giving Him the right to order our lives the way He wants instead of the way that feels good to us, that's another question that we're not always ready to answer. We want Him to be our Messiah, the promised one of God, who will take us to heaven to spend eternity with Him. But are we willing for Him to be our Master? What should it look like when we surrender to Jesus as Lord? Well, there's a passage in Luke 14 where Jesus addresses that. Starting in verse 26, the very first thing that He identifies as to what it should look like with Him as our Lord is that it's all about our priorities. He says, if you want to be my disciples, you must, by comparison, hate everyone else. Now, he's not, I guess that sounds like hate speech, doesn't it? But that's not really what he's talking about. Remember, the phrase that he uses there is, in comparison to your love and devotion to me, everything that you feel for others in your life should look like you hate them. And he talks about family like father, mother, wife, children, brothers and sisters. Yes, even your own life. Otherwise, he says, you cannot be my disciple. Now, it's not a qualification thing, like you're disqualified, nearly as much as Jesus is saying, it's not ever going to work. It's not going to work for you to be my disciple if you're not willing to put me first. Now, the context of this is that he had just finished telling a parable about a man who had hosted a great feast in verse 16. He'd sent out all the invitations, got the RSVP back. Yep, count on me, I'll be there. And letting everyone know then that, hey, it's time, the banquet's ready, you need to come. And that's when the excuses began to roll in. From everyone who had already agreed, I'll be there, you can count on me. One guy responds, I've just bought a field. Well, you know, you may or may not buy farms, but we do understand how sometimes business gets in the way of our commitment to follow Jesus. Another one says, I've just bought 5 pairs of oxen. And again, I'm not even sure how many of you have even seen an ox, let alone 2 of them or 10 of them. But nonetheless, it had to do with his farming, which was his business, which was his future. And buying 5 pairs of them was a significant investment in the way that he was going to secure his future. And the third one says, you got to forgive me, I just got married. Everybody knows, happy wife, happy life. And the wife says, no way. They'd already agreed. They'd already given him their word. They'd already said, yes, I want to do this. But like with many today who want to be a Christian, when the time comes, somehow there's a struggle with finding the right priority. You see, our natural inclination is to make excuses, especially if there's something that we think is a better deal, something that's a better offer, something that's going to pay more rewards sooner. And the point is, God can make us unshakable. He's promised to do that. But Jesus says, if you want to be unshakable, then you'll have to follow me without excuses. I have to be the priority in your life. Follow me or don't follow me. There's no middle ground. Trying to do both at the same time, it's just not going to work. You can't be my disciple and have it both ways. In verse 27 through 28, a second thing that Jesus identifies is, if you're going to make that kind of a decision, if you're going to make that kind of a choice, you need to count the cost. He says, and if you do not carry your own cross and follow me, again, it's just not going to work. Trying to be my disciple and not being willing to carry the cross. Again, the context is that their country at that point in time was not ruled by their own people. They were not self-ruled. They were dominated by the Roman Empire. They'd conquered the world, including their part of the world. And they'd done so by being ruthless and ruling their empire by fear. They were experts at breaking the will of those people that they had defeated. They had to, or else they would resist, they would rebel, and they would try to retaliate. So the best way to maintain peace in the country that you just defeated would be to make it so outrageous to consider retaliating against them or rebelling against their rules that no one would even consider it. And so they would do that with mass executions. You could even call it genocide. But they did that by crucifixion. They chose to do that not just by making people disappear, but by making them public spectacles, hanging them along the road, coming into and going out of towns, on a pole, a cross, and leaving them there. They would humiliate people, not only by sentencing them to death, but then by making them carry their own cross to their own execution. Verses 28 through 30, that's why he says, don't even begin if you can't afford to finish it. And he uses a couple of illustrations about building a house. In verses 31 and 32, he says, don't even start a fight if you don't have what it takes to finish it. And he would talk about one country going against another in war. But the principle is simply this. Our natural inclination is to let our fears determine our decisions. And the point that he makes is that God can make us unshakable, but Jesus says to do so, you'll have to commit to follow me and follow through no matter what. Follow through. Commitment. That must not just be a problem today. It must have been a problem of human nature, even back in Jesus' day, where people have all of the best intentions, they have all of the interest that you could have, but they were completely wishy-washy in whether or not they were going to follow through, especially if your life depended upon it. And that's why Jesus says in verse 33, you'll need to surrender if you want me to be your Lord. The passage says, so therefore any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. And again, it's not a matter of whether you're qualified or disqualified. It was an issue of it's just not going to work. Think square peg, round hole. You can pound it all day long, but it's just not going to fit. It's just not going to work. The round hole was, you have things in your life that mean a lot to you. The square peg was, how do you follow Jesus and try to hold on to those? The Message refers to this passage in Luke 14, verse 33 like this. If you're not willing to take whatever's dearest to you, whether it's people, plans, or possessions, and kiss it goodbye, you can't be my disciple. Again, the context is, this whole conversation began when Jesus was at a banquet and saw how people were reacting out of envy, pride, and jealousy. Their own arrogance was motivating them to try to outmaneuver each other for the best seat of honor at the banquet table. That's why in verse 11 of Luke 14, Jesus says, those who exalt themselves will be humbled. He's talking about people who are so driven and obsessed to be recognized by others as, wow, he must really be important, or wow, he must really be liked by this person, that they would be willing to risk humiliation if they were asked to vacate that seat for, say, a brother or someone who had a closer relation and connection to them. In verse 12, he says, at the resurrection, righteousness will be rewarded more than the politics of popularity. You see, that's really what it was amounting to. The context was that Jesus saw people caught up in the politics of the moment, the politics of popularity, and he says, God's not going to reward that. Instead, he'll reward people who do the right thing by people who need the right thing done for them. Righteousness will be what God rewards. And yet, our natural inclination is to let the opinion of others determine the choices that we make. What will they think if I do this? God can make us unshakable. But according to Jesus, that's only going to happen when we learn to value the things that He values. We'll only become unshakable when nothing matters to us more than Him. So Jesus wants to know, what do you want more? What are you willing to surrender to me? You know, we used to sing a song, I surrender all, I surrender all. And yet, based upon the current condition, then as well as today, it would probably be better off if we would sing it truthfully. I surrender some. I surrender the spare change in the couch. You see, it won't be easy or convenient to be unshakable in being a disciple of Jesus, with Him as the Lord of our life. He knew there would be people whose faith would be shaken, even by the things that He'd said. And He knew that they would walk away. The rich young ruler was one of those people who did just that. When Jesus told him, are you willing to surrender everything that you value and follow after me? Are you willing to benefit others instead of worrying about whether it's going to benefit you? There have been people who have always chosen a path of convenience instead of conviction and commitment. There have been people who used to sit in this very room, in these very chairs, maybe even beside you in the row that you sit in, who've been shaken by the events and the choices that they've made in their life, or by the choices that other people have made. And over the years, there have been some who've stood on this very stage and led you in worship, led you in prayer, took you to the throne in consideration of the Lord's Supper. And they've seen their commitment shaken as well. And when we see that, that can shake our faith also, can it? And even though it may surprise us, God is not surprised by men and women who are ready to walk away, shaken by the choices that they made. An unshakable faith has never been easy, nor has it been convenient. Just a quick skim through of Hebrews chapter 11 and a review of the list of people who are there remembered for their great faith tells you that it wasn't always easy for them. He identifies people like Noah. It wasn't always easy. It wasn't always convenient. It had to be a strong conviction and commitment that he made to follow through, to value what God valued, and to make it the top priority in his life. Abraham, leaving everything behind, being afraid of the potential challenges along the way. His wife Sarah, overcoming the resentment that she must have felt when Abraham would lie about her and put her and her morals at risk. Their kids and grandkids, Isaac and Jacob. What about Moses? Israel, the people of God, took 40 years to get to the promised land, and they certainly spent their time waffling back and forth, being tossed to and fro in their conviction about, are we really willing to trust God and Moses? And he mentions guys like Gideon and Samson, and then there's David. A checkered past at best. Questionable decisions, certainly. And yet, it says in Hebrews 11, verse 33 and 34, that it was by their faith that people like them overthrew kingdoms. They ruled with justice. They received what God had promised them. Their weakness was turned into strength. It sounds to me like God made them unshakable in spite of who they were. And then in verse 35, it says that others refused to turn from God to escape their torture. They placed their hope in a better life after the resurrection. They were unshakable despite the fact that things never got better for them in this world. Their unshakable faith led to an unshakable commitment to the death. No, an unshakable faith has never been easy or convenient. And yet God promises to make us unshakable if we surrender to Jesus as our Lord. Not the Lord of our parents, not the Lord of our community, but our Lord. And even when life is turned upside down, they were unshakable in their surrender to Jesus as Lord. I mean, what about John the Baptist? Did he have his moments? Yes, he did. Are you the one that we should look for, or should we look for another one? He said from his jail cell before he was executed and beheaded. Peter and the rest of the disciples, I'll never leave you, even if everyone else does. And yet, before the rooster crowed, he'd already denied him three times. The seven churches of Asia in Revelation, most of them had forgotten their first love. They failed to follow through on their commitment and chose instead convenience. God can make us unshakable if we surrender to Jesus as Lord. But to do so means you have to make Him your number one priority without excuses. You have to be willing to follow through no matter what, regardless of what happens. And the third thing is you have to do that because you've learned to value what He values most. Well, I don't know if I can do that. What if I fail? What if I fall? Well, the good news is you can be forgiven. You're not unshakable on your own, but God promises to make you unshakable. When you live your life, surrender to Jesus as the Lord of your life and as the Master who has control over your life. Your priorities are His, your values are His, and your commitment to follow through is inspired by Him. Paul would say it this way in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, God began doing a good work in you, and I am confident that He will continue until it is finished when Jesus Christ comes again. Let me close with this question. Are you living a life of surrender to Jesus, with Jesus as your Lord? He's more than your Savior, He's your Lord. He's more than your Messiah, He's your Master. What are you building your hope on? What is your anchor in the storm? What is your strength when you're weak? And on that final day when the angelic trumpet sounds to signal His return, what will you treasure most and cling to? Is Jesus the cornerstone that you have built an unshakable faith?